Hello, boys and girls. Welcome to another episode of the Steebee Weebee Show. Hope you're doing well. We have a special guest today, Robert Carranza. Award-winning engineer. What was that?
Did you piss and not wash your hands?
Oh, no. It just drizzled out.
Give me a big
one. Thanks for coming, man. Jeez, you caught me off guard. I was scared. So it says here, you got a lot. Your discography is vast.
Bullshit.
This guy's a Grammy-winning record producer, engineer. He's worked with Mars Volta, Jack Johnson, Beck, Eels, and it goes on and on, doesn't it?
Yeah, it's all lies.
It's not. They're not lies. Did you want to...
Most importantly, I work with Monchi.
And he did work with Monchi. Thanks again for mastering our album. I know
you
put a lot of time and effort into it.
Yeah.
What was your favorite song off the album?
Skateboard.
The skateboard?
Yeah,
maybe. That was an accident.
Made me tear up a little bit.
Because you were there that night at the warehouse when I was fucking around with the keyboard?
Yeah.
Okay.
I saw the magic happen in front
of
me.
Yeah.
Brings a tear to my eye.
You don't even know what kind of gear this guy has. It looks like
just high.
Yeah, like a rocket ship inside your studio. What got you into music and the business and...
Oh, good question.
You're from East LA, right?
I was born in, he's born in Whittier, Montebello area.
Yeah.
Went to East LA as a kid. Then grew up primarily as my teenage years in Alhambra, Monterey
Alhambra,
Park. But, we were just kids. We were in a band. We were like 11 years old. We started a band.
Do you have a picture of that band when you had long hair?
Motherfucker.
You have to show them.
All right.
This guy, was it a metal band?
We were a metal band.
Oh, my goodness.
We were called Lethargik.
Lethargik. This is the best band picture ever you'll ever see. Please show them.
Hold on.
Hold your horses. It's worth the wait.
All right.
Lethargik.
I'm going to get you back.
From East Los. And I hope there's an album out there that the viewers could...
Yes.
Which one are you? You're the guy in the white.
The skinny guy who used to be skinny a long time fucking ago.
Let me see. That's you.
Yeah.
Wow, that's beautiful hair.
You know what's funny?
Beautiful.
That guy right there?
Yeah.
Is now the bass player for Morrissey.
For Morrissey?
Yeah. He played with Fear for a while, and then he played with Kim Deal from...
Pixies.
Pixies.
I love the Pixies.
Now he plays with Morrissey.
Wow, so he's been in it for that long, huh?
We've both been in it for a long time, yeah. I mean, at one point we just kind of fell apart,
as
a lot of bands do, you know?
How long were you guys together? You guys did a lot of shows, like, in L.A.? What year was this, just to give them a reference
83.
Point? 83, dude.
Yeah, we signed around 84. We were actually playing, like, 82, but...
82? Where are the clubs still around?
No. It was Gazzari's, which is now...
Gazzari's. Where was
that? That was right by the Rainbow.
Off Sunset?
Yeah, I think it's called the Limelight. No, not the Limelight. That was New York.
It's right.
So if you go out towards the Bank of America and across there, there's a club there now. That used to be Gazzari's.
Gazzari's.
Old guy with like... Italian guy with this white hat. He had a bunch of girls around him all the time.
What?
And he ran the place like you wouldn't believe. Our problem with LA at the time was that we were kind of like a thrash band.
Yeah.
Like a metal band.
That's cool, though.
Yeah, and that time was all about hair metal. So you had the...
What's the difference?
Well, it's like we were harder. We were like
punk rock. Oh, right,
heavier.
Right.
And there was
And then give me an example of a hair metal band, like Striper?
Yeah, Striper or Rat.
Oh, right, right. Know? I remember Rat and Striper. Yeah, right, yeah. Stuff like that.
And there was and every band... there was a scene that happened in Hollywood that was just so funny.
What year again? 83?
85,
okay. 83. 85, there's 85 now.
Yeah, that whole time frame.
Okay.
Everyone would walk from Whiskey A Go-Go all the way up to the Rainbow. And then they would do a circle and then come back down.
So that was a hot spot.
It was like cruising on the street.
So that, it was way different back in the day Sunset.
Yeah.
Because kids go to Echo Park now, man. They don't even go to Sunset. Yeah. Maybe the Beverly Hills kids or something.
No, no, this was like...
They go to
Echo Park. Was like the craziest thing from the really rich, you know...
Yeah.
Families who had money, and then, you know, the poor kids who were coming from East LA and from other neighborhoods.
They go to Sunset?
To go to Sunset. And it was like you were all the same. If you had cool clothes, big hair, you know...
Yeah.
And it was all about getting blowjobs in the back of some, you know, bush somewhere or... Yeah. You know.
That's never happened to me at a Monchi show. But, hey, maybe I was born in the wrong era.
Motley Crue had a house.
It was I want to hear about Motley Crue.
So Motley Crue had this house.
Where?
It was on the corner just above from the Whiskey A Go-Go.
By the Comedy Store?
No. It was further
up. West.
Yeah, it was further west. So it was further like west. If you were at the Whiskey A Go-Go, you'd go up and there was this house they had. It was really like an open door apartment.
Motley Crue. They're still around, aren't they?
Yeah, they're still around. I mean, I used to see them. The first time I saw them was in West Covina at a backyard party.
What year?
It was probably...
85 again?
No, it was probably 83 or 82.
Wow.
Something like that. It was incredible. They were I mean, you know, as much as some people might say...
Because they were huge on MTV back then, man. Yeah. I remember as a kid seeing MTV and Motley Crue was everywhere.
Well, they brought the theater.
Yeah, they had the theatrics, right?
Theatrics. They had that theatrics in the backyard party. Tommy Lee's dad, I guess, was some sort of like engineer or something.
What is he known for, though?
I have no idea. Oh, the hog.
Big penis. Very big penis.
But I don't know if you had that.
But didn't Pamela have a porn with him on a boat?
Yeah.
He's got a thick one. But I didn't mean
it. I haven't seen it.
Yeah, I haven't seen. Well, I remember seeing that porn and saying, God, there, that's like a monster. A monster.
I just thought it'd be better left to be unseen.
Right.
For my own lack of.
Yeah. Go on with your Motley Crue stories, man.
No, so the first time I saw him was this backyard party, and it was incredible because they had like fireworks.
How many people were there?
200, 300 people.
Damn, they had a lot of groupies of it.
A lot of groupies, yeah.
A lot. A
lot. Yeah, I mean, they were probably the standard that everyone wanted to be.
They were on top of the mountain.
They were on top, yeah. Yeah.
What about Van Halen?
Van Halen was a different vibe. Oh, different, they were a little earlier.
Yeah.
And they were already way more popular than Motley Crue at that time frame.
Wow.
I mean, I don't remember when Women and Children came out or Diver Down. It was definitely before them, though.
Right.
And then Motley Crue did the US Festival. I think that was 83.
This guy knows his stuff.
83, 84. Which was put on by Apple.
Really?
Yeah, Steve Wozniak. He put on a concert app. It was in Glen Helen Gardens, off the 15 now.
Wow.
That was where the US Festival was, yeah.
Wow, dude. That's incredible. Some history there, huh?
Yeah.
Do you have any more like groupie stories about them?
About them?
Or just about rock and roll? I like thinking about like how it was for bands like that.
It was funny back then. You know, one of the things that I think people are taking themselves a little too serious now, you know, when it comes to...
Like, with music in general?
Well, music and how they kind of like feel about where they are in life, you know. It's like back then it was a little freer.
Right, know, like more hippie vibe?
Yeah, a little hippie, but like, you know, no one really, you know...
Free love?
Free love a little bit, yeah.
Like, so it was like post-70s, where kind of the vibes stuck around?
Yeah. I mean, there was a whole thing with girls that was insane. It was
like,
just
what do you mean?
Well,
like their style?
I mean, you could throw a rock and, you know, get a girl to sleep with you.
Back then?
Yeah, it was just crazy. I remember walking down the Sunset Strip And again, we weren't guys that had like big hair. We were like Metallica.
Those were our
friends, you know?
Yeah.
Like James grew up in Downey. We used to go to this record store called Middle Earth over there and hang out and buy records from European, you know?
Jeez. And like 45s and stuff like
that? 45s, yeah, 45s, LPs. But I remember, you know, we were the like ugly dudes walking down the street,
you know? And you got the girls still because you're in a band?
Yeah, you're in a band. And I remember walking down the street going like, one of my friends was like, ah, that girl has a nice ass. And it was like, I took a look.
And just say, hey, you want to come back with me?
Well, he went and tapped her shoulder, and it was not a girl, it was a guy.
Oh. Yeah.
And the guy was like, fuck you, man.
Yeah, yeah. So back then, a lot of people had long hair, huh?
Yeah. It was the.
So was that easy for them to get groupies?
Well, you know, even guys who, it's like, you couldn't tell who the roadie was, or you couldn't tell who...
But the roadie's got some action, too.
I have no idea.
Something was wrong with the dynamic of Manchi. I think our fan base is 95% dudes.
Well, there you go.
Maybe two girls.
Maybe you can get lucky with a guy.
I don't know about that, but if they're going to come and support and buy a ticket, I'm down for that.
Well, that's the thing. That's the point. Yeah. Back then... One of the great things is that you had diehard fans, man.
Back then.
Yeah, it was just.
I got like tattoos of the band. Fans.
Like everything.
Oh, wow.
You know, it's like if you. One of the things that was crazy about back then, it was pay to play.
So you pay to play?
Yeah, you had to sell tickets.
That's.
It's whack.
That's whack.
It's still, I think it still happens to this time. Today. Oh. But back
what
then.
What if you already have a fan base?
Didn't matter. That was the thing. It was a social event. You went out and you passed out flyers every weekend.
Wow. You hung off flyers. Off the boulevard?
Off the boulevard. You gave flyers, you hung them on the street, you hung them on post signs.
Yeah.
You put them everywhere, and that was a good way to talk to a girl by going like, right, hey, come check out my band.
Now, were you around when the whole Rodney Bingenheimer thing?
Yeah, Rodney Bingenheimer.
Didn't he have a club off Sunset Boulevard where all the like the big acts?
It was
like,
English Acid.
And that was literally, that's like a Taekwondo studio now, right?
Yeah. But there was also a place called the Starwoods. That was off of San Vicente.
Okay. And
Starwoods was a little alternative. Now that was more like from late 70s hitting into the 80s.
Wow. You know?
But it's around, yeah.
And then so there was all the big acts went there.
Bands like Faster Pussycat.
David Bowie?
Bowie, yeah.
Lou Reed.
I never got to go see that, but it was just a little bit before my time.
Yeah, yeah. But, that would have been amazing, man.
But I did go to a show at Starwood. I saw Motley Crue at Starwood.
Wow.
They were one of the bands that played there a lot.
Now, didn't you work with the Beastie Boys?
Work with Beasties, yeah.
Me and what album? Because I'm a huge fan of their stuff.
It's kind
of
like the last running Hell Nasty.
Okay, yeah, I bought that tape at Warehouse.
Yeah. And
Those of you who don't know what Warehouse
used Warehouse to, Records.
It used to be like a Tower Records, you know.
Yeah.
Like a record store tape. You know, they don't have them anymore.
Yeah.
You know, they're extinct.
Yeah. I mean, it was funny. I met Mario probably...
So explain to the viewers who Mario C is. Because the Beasties referred to Mario all C a lot in their lyrics.
Yeah, yeah. I met Mario in the early 90s at a party. It was a backyard party kind of thing. And we kept on always talking
about... How did you meet
them
dudes?
Well, I'm from Mario. Because I met Mario and he kept on... At that time, I was working on... Like rock records.
Yeah, you know?
It was like worked on some of the. I was more at that time an assistant engineer in a studio.
Yeah.
Got to work on all these records and stuff. So we're at a party and I met this guy Mario and he asked me like, "Hey man, we should do something." But he was doing Beasties at the time.
What album were they on?
I think they were.
Well, it was before Check Your. Was it Paul's Boutique or Check Your Head?
No, they were just finishing Paul's Boutique.
That's my favorite album. That's record. My favorite album, man.
Yeah, they were just finishing
High Plains Drifter, Eggman. That's my shit. Yeah. I love that album. There's so many layers in
there. Oh, yeah. It's a great record. I mean, the truth...
And that's Dust Brothers, right?
That was Mike and John. Easy
so
Mike.
You know the Dust Brothers,
I
too?
Do. Yeah, good friends.
Mike Simpson. You told me a story about that. You said they met the Dust Brothers. That album was already done, like an instrumental kind of album. And then the Beasties heard it and they wanted to rap over it.
That's
Is
correct.
That true?
That's correct.
Yeah, that See, there's some history done. Right there. So that album was originally a Dust Brothers album.
A Dust Brothers record, yeah.
Record. The Beasties heard it and wanted. They're like, what is that? And So the music was already done.
Correct.
So they just rapped over it.
They came in and they were like, what is this? And they wanted it.
They wanted the whole thing.
They wanted the whole thing. And then they put their vocals on it, and the rest is history.
And that's the type of album, during the time period, people slept on it, kind of?
Yeah.
And then later on, people got it. They're like, whoa, this is so layered and awesome.
Yeah, I think Paul's Boutique will go be known as one of the most underrated records ever made.
And then
all of a sudden, it was something you discovered later on in life.
You're like, this is amazing.
Yeah. Because most people...
Everything about it I loved. Yeah. Everything.
Because it was Licensed to Ill.
That was a banger, too.
Yeah.
I mean, that was their intro album.
But it went from that, and I think it went to Check Your Head. Yeah. So the middle...
Wait. Wasn't Paul's Boutique before Check Your Head?
Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
Okay, so Licensed to Ill, Check Your Head.
No, Paul's Boutique.
Paul's Boutique, Check Your Head.
So a lot
of... Communication?
A lot of people, yeah, a lot of people jumped over.
That was a great album, too. Did you work on that, too?
No, not on that one.
But you worked on...
On Hell Nasty. With Mark. Yeah. And Mark.
I mean, the packaging on that with the tape, I remember it was like... It looked like, you know, a thing where you put candy...
Yeah.
And you would flip it up, and then the tape would slide out.
Yeah.
It was great marketing and packaging on their
part. And I met Mark at a backstage at a Blind Melon concert.
Money?
Yeah, Money Mark.
How long have you known Mark?
About 20 years, something now. Yeah.
20 years, dude.
Yeah.
There's some history there.
Yeah. And my time there during the early 90s was really rock records. I was really working on, like, rock record stuff, but...
But... You work with Marilyn Manson, too, right?
Yeah, just finished up his new record, yeah.
And I know you got some stories about that. Right.
Yeah, Manson's an interesting character.
Like, I want to hear about kind of like who's hanging out in the studio, who these girls are, and, stuff like that.
Yeah.
If you want to get into it, but you don't have to. He's got some groupies, too, doesn't he?
He sure does, yeah. Yeah.
Are they like... Hardcore goth chicks?
No,
or?
It's very interesting to see the people who kind of come to him. It's like, I've seen some hardcore goth looking girls.
Yeah.
You know, sadder than sad.
Yeah.
But I've also seen some very beautiful, enlightened women. I mean, he's dated some really pretty amazing women.
He's not like satanic or
nothing.
That's his image, right?
He's the kind of guy who likes to push buttons.
Right.
You know, I'm not giving any secrets away.
Manson
kind of likes to come out, and he's a man who likes to push buttons and push boundaries and see how far he can take it to the edge. And sometimes he slips over, you know, falls into the cave. But most of the time he's taking it to the edge, and he's a really, really nice guy. I mean, it's not the...
So he is nice.
Yeah, he's a great guy, and he's been great to work for the past two records.
Yeah,
But at the same time, you know, with him, he dances on the razor blade. You know.
Now with all these, you know, I didn't want to like go back and forth, but like even with Motley Crue, is cocaine involved with a lot of this stuff?
You know, drugs are a funny thing in this business.
Because, you know, rock and roll and...
This would probably hit the most heaviest, but just, like, I've seen more people, friends who are my friends, that died than I can even count on my hands.
Because of drugs?
Drugs. I mean, it's an impossible life to live. You know?
The rock and roll life.
Rock and roll life.
Yeah, I can only imagine.
Because what happens is you're this young punk who's trying to make it, and the odds are against you.
Yeah.
And then all of a sudden someone goes like, hey, you think you got what it takes... And they give you a bunch of money.
Yeah.
And you make a hit song and you make a bunch of money. And then you start going places where you're admired.
Yeah.
Revered. People want to touch you. People want to know anything about you.
Like Justin Bieber.
Exactly.
I mean, he's like the highest.
Yeah.
Man.
I mean, there's a lot of them. And what happens is sometimes those demons are just sitting waiting for you when you get home.
And the demons in your mind.
Wherever.
Yeah.
Drugs, whatever. And then... You have to deal with them, you know.
Right.
They don't. They don't go away.
Yeah.
You just push them aside, and then they reveal themselves. And some people have made it, and some people haven't. You know, it's a hard thing. It's the weirdest thing I've seen. Again, I've seen one guy become rich and famous in a week,
just off a song.
That's all you need.
Man, like, I wanted to get into that, too. Like, how... You've been around the record business or the music business for a long time. How has it changed, you know, with all this technology and, like, less physical sales? Yeah. And like, what's your take on that?
Well, we come to a place where it's freeing.
It's what?
It's freeing.
It's freeing.
It's like, so it's, any band
could just make it.
Can make a record. And you have no limitations
of what you could do.
Of what you can do.
You don't really need labels now, or?
Well, I wouldn't say you do. It's funny. It's, you know, I stopped kind of working for labels around 10 years ago, and I just start working for artists, which means that before you have to, you used to go into a meeting.
Who's your favorite artist you've worked with?
Oh, they're putting me on the spot. Monchi.
Great answer. Fantastic answer.
Yeah. But what happened is the music industry took a big turn, you know, after Napster and after all that,
that
kind
stuff,
of shit.
Yeah.
But it really didn't. What really happened was the record industry could not open their eyes to what was coming.
Right.
So Napster was a little piece of it, but there was much more of a mountain to climb that was happening that they just couldn't see.
Right, right.
And now,
because nowadays people could just freaking jack your stuff online. There's MP3 sites. You just boom, just yeah. They just download their stuff.
I mean, you know, I have my own little hiccups with that. It's like I think intellectual property is important. You know,
right.
I mean, it's content that you're making.
Yeah.
I think you should be paid for it. You know,
compensated at least.
Compensated to a certain degree. I mean, look at man.
I know, I didn't want to get into that side of it, yeah. But like, you know, like we had Mark here, he didn't really get into it, yeah. But like, and you've dealt with that side of it, the yeah. ugly side of yeah. not getting paid for your work, right? Yeah.
But also, I've been privileged.
What do you mean
in
by
my
that?
Career? I mean, I've, you know,
just
I've,
the people I've, you've worked with and stuff?
Yeah, I mean, I've made my bones in this career, and I'm not saying that I've done my best work or I'm not doing my best work later. It's just like, how much is everything? How much is it like, how much is too much?
Like, you know? Like in regards of to what?
Just success or fame right, or any right. of that stuff. You know what I mean? Do you need, you know, do you need a fucking...
A mansion?
No, you don't.
Not really.
No. Do you need a private...
I mean, I wouldn't mind living in a micro home, you know?
Whatever. I just think, yeah. you know...
It's but a micro home, you know, yeah. that's all I need.
Yeah, this business has been good to me, so it's like, I can't really...
Would you live in a micro home?
My wife is starting to talk about moving out of LA a lot more.
Off the grid, dude.
Yeah.
Off the grid. Yeah. Solar panels, right?
Yeah. We have a
my what are those toilets? A compost toilet?
Compost toilet.
Compost yeah. toilets. Little loft up there. Put a little bed. Little cabin.
Well, you've been in my studio.
It's amazing.
Solar powered.
It is?
Yeah.
I loved it. I love it. I love it. Yeah.
Jack Johnson. You know, Jack Johnson. We have a studio in Hawaii and we have a studio here.
Jack Johnson is known for his Curious George album, right?
That I mean, it's one of his, yeah.
That's a great song. I don't know what's it called? Yeah.
Upside Down.
Yeah. Great song. Yeah. I mean, they'll play that in airports and hotels.
Yeah, I think
everywhere.
It's 12 years now with Jack.
How much did he make on that song?
Oh, I have no idea.
Some millions, probably. Huh?
Yeah. That was a different time.
One song.
Yeah, you can make, I mean, that's the thing. You can write one song in retire. And there's been a lot of people who have.
Just one song?
One song. Become a one-hit wonder.
And you're good.
Yeah. I mean, Jack's far from not that. I mean, we've
but made he's got, he got some money, right?
Yeah, he's fine.
Yeah.
Know? He gives back all the time.
He's a good dude, right?
Great guy.
Didn't you work with Beck, too?
Work with Beck, yeah.
Because I love that album, Mutations.
Yeah, Midnight Vultures. Odelay,
yeah, mm-hmm. Odelay.
Yeah, that was Rob Schnapp and... Tom Rothrock.
Oh, when I worked at Amoeba, I rang him up. I was at register 3, and I was like starting to sweat because I knew maybe I was next in line to get him, and he walked up, and I was paralyzed. I was just shaking like. You find everything okay? And then like you know what I mean? Like it was him, and I'm like. I don't know why, because it's, you know, the thing about Amoeba is like, you'll see, I mean, Henry Rollins came in, I mean, the rapper Slug from Atmosphere, you know, I've seen acts come in, but I don't know, with him, I was just like seeing like a god or something. It's really weird.
Yeah. I never
but
had.
He's a normal.
He's a normal guy.
He's a quiet, nice guy, isn't he?
Yeah, yeah.
But I was shaking. I was like, oh, I love your album. mutations.
I mean, I think, you know, for someone like Beck, you know, it's really, there's a point when you become, you know, famous or whatever, and then you really don't know what people's intentions are.
So yeah.
You walk around and, like, you can catch people staring at you.
Yeah, yeah.
You get this corner side of your eye, and you're like, oh, man, that guy's, like, staring at me. And
dude, Mark told me a crazy story of a groupie going up to Beck. Do you know this story?
Maybe, I don't know.
He said that...
She kissed him?
No, she kissed him, but then she bit him like a vampire.
That's right. I heard something about that, yeah.
Yeah, so Beck was at somewhere, right? And Mark was around, and this groupie or fan came up and goes, I love your music. And then instead of, she went in and tried to bite his neck like a vampire. Yeah. And Mark told me that after that incident, like, he was freaked out with, like, the public or something.
Yeah.
Did you hear about this story?
Yeah, yeah.
She tried to bite him.
Yeah, yeah, she tried to bite him, yeah. There was another one who came up to him and grabbed him by the balls. I mean, there's been...
They could grab his nuts.
I mean, it's funny, man. You know, you think you know these people, but you really don't. You know, it's like... Some of these... I mean, like, I'll give you an example. It's like Jack. It's like, you know, he's a super nice guy, really cool. Anyone can walk up to him, but do you really think you know him? You really don't.
You don't.
You don't. You don't know his life.
So these people are just basing it on, like, maybe this crazy fan's listening to a song on repeat, like, all night, and, like, thinks she has it figured out about him or something. Yeah.
Well, you got to remember, what you write means something to you.
Right.
But it's completely interpreted separately.
Differently than other people, to the listener.
Yeah.
That's interesting, yeah, man.
I mean, you can, there's metaphors, there's everything you can think of, but really what it comes down to is whoever's sitting there listening to it, you've turned on a spark in them.
Right,
or
right.
Or something that you were like, oh, there's a connection there.
No doubt.
And
no
that
doubt.
Connection is powerful.
Is to the listener.
Yeah.
Not to the artist.
Well, it could be. It could be. Because, you know, you go on stage, you feed off what they give you.
Right.
I mean, I've seen you on stage and David and the guys.
I wear a nut cup. So I'm...
And
I just
know,
let it all out.
But you're also reacting to what they're doing.
Yeah. I'm very sensitive to them. Because you're there to entertain. It's not about me. I want them to have a good time.
Sure.
So I'm like, hey, sometimes, like, in our New York show at SOBs, the people in the front, I go, hey, like, in between songs, like, yeah, you guys having a good time? And that's it.
Yeah.
Because they paid the money for the ticket.
But there's people there who are, you know, you got to remember, they're looking at you like you're back.
Oh, don't say that.
No, they do. Oh. I've seen it. I've been to the shows. I've seen people, you know.
It's never a pretty girl, though, is it? It's always some kind of mid-20s kid.
Yeah, some little 20
ethnic kid. With a jean jacket or something.
Pikachu on his back or something. Pikachu on his back.
Oh, I love Arthur. I love Pikachu. Didn't you work with Rage Against the Machine, too?
You worked with
Zach De La Rocha, right?
Yeah.
Because he's awesome. We all love Zach, right?
We did One Day as a Lion. We're currently working on the next record.
Is he still active? Like, he did stuff with Run the Jewels, right? With LP and everything?
Yeah, he just did a new song and put out a song with Run, with LP producing. And, you know, John Theodore is a drummer, and the One Day as a Lion is Zach and John. And we've been
Why don't they reunite or to Rage Against... people are waiting for that. The Rage Against Machine... kind of that's a reunion.
That's a complicated...
It's a sensitive topic,
No,
isn't it?
I don't think it's sensitive. I just think it's more complicated than what most people know. You know, they just think that, you know, hey, it's easy to just get in a room with everybody and do a thing. But there's 20 years of history that of
I mean, those shows must have been... I mean, they ran L.A., right?
There were some...
They had an album,
Battle of Los Angeles.
Of Los Angeles,
I mean,
right?
I tell you... I've been to some of the shows where it's almost...
This is in the 90s then, right? Yeah. It's not 80s. This is the 90s now, right?
Yeah.
Okay, yeah.
Where you're in the room and it feels like the room's levitating. I mean, that's a crazy feeling. People just...
At a Rage show?
Yeah, just in sync, jumping up and down. You're like, whoa, this place is going to fall apart.
Like electric.
Yeah. I mean, I went to see them at... There was a club in Tijuana called Iguanas.
They performed in Tijuana?
Yeah, Iguanas. It was a real famous nightclub. It was them, Bad Brains...
Oh, dude.
It was a weird place. It was three stories high.
Oh, and I would have loved to have been at that
show. They had chain
show.
Link fences because people were dying.
If you're in San Diego, you you best believe you went to that show, dude. That's just like, boom, across the board, you're there.
It was one of the craziest
drinking Modelo's, just chilling, waiting for the craziest concert
The craziest thing was that it was weird because it was just like this one little venue and there was like a huge parking lot around it.
Wow. And then that would have been amazing.
Yeah, it was crazy. But one kid.
You were there?
Yeah.
You were at that show?
Jumped off the top tier, broke his neck, gone.
God, music has that much of an effect. I mean, this kid was.
He died. I mean, it was.
It hypnotized
him. It was crazy. I mean, it was crazy.
He did a WWF, like, top rope.
If I remember, this is a long time ago, if I remember correctly, he was on something, but he, you know, it was like, those are shows. I mean, they're crazy shows.
And I bet you the tickets were like $5, $10. Yeah. Because of Tijuana, you know what I mean?
Yeah. Yeah, there was a lot of clubs around here that had great shows. There was San Pedro's, the Dancing Waters Club. There was Goodies in Fullerton.
Right.
You know, just kind of alternative places to Hollywood.
Dude, you are like an encyclopedia of like history as far as music and venues and
Born and raised in here. Born and raised in Los Angeles and in the business for a long time, so.
A long time.
Long time.
Now, like going back to Zach, De La Roca, and Rage, have you been in public with them? Because I used to work at Coffee Bean. Yeah. And Tea Leaf on Hillhurst.
Yeah.
And I trained at that store, and I remember...
That was the spot.
Yeah. I saw him there, and it was the same time. I didn't freak out like I did with Beck, but I was looking at him like... The time I saw Sons of Stark at In-N-Out Burger, I was just like looking at him like... Wow, that's him.
Lucky Strikes?
Yeah! He was smoking a cigarette, drinking his coffee, and I was just staring at him like a creep. I was like, wow, that's him.
Zach's a complicated guy, man. He loves his kind of like
it's privacy.
Fun. He loves his privacy, but at the same time, he gives so much out of himself.
Just his fans.
I mean, not even his fans, just his lyrics, his words, what he performs. You know, recently we were at working and
wait, how recently?
A couple months ago because we took a break.
So that's cool. He's still writing and doing.
Well, that was the thing. We were sitting there, and you know. There was a sheet of paper in front of me, and he had written some lyrics.
Is that his apartment?
This is a studio, yeah.
He went to your studio?
No, we have a studio. We have our own little spot.
Okay, cool. I won't ask where it is.
And, I told him, I'm like, you know what, man? You know what's funny? I was like, this sheet of paper means nothing when I write on it.
But when you write on it?
When I write on it. But when he writes something on it, it can change the world. Like, you know.
That's insane.
That's
right?
a weird responsibility, too. Yeah. You know what I mean?
Because there's fans that look up to him like he's that dude, like that revolutionary writer. You know what I'm saying? They're like looking at him like, hey, you're the leader, lead us.
Yeah.
So I'm sure fans have, like, just kind of went up to him, dude, please, man, please get back together, man, please.
And that's a weird responsibility.
But have you seen that?
I've seen it.
Where dudes get, like, out of, like just, like, hounding him?
Yeah. And, you know, they're not
How does he
up.
Diffuse that when you got, like, a passionate fan coming at him that way?
I can't speak for him, but...
But you've seen it with your own eyes.
Yeah,
like,
I've seen how people
react. Does he just walk away?
No, he doesn't walk away. He just, you know, he just kind of handles it... He has his way of handling it. It's different every time, but he's just like, oh, man, it's all good, man. We'll see what happens, you know. It's like,
wow.
It's hard to diffuse a situation like that, you know?
When
someone's like, oh, what's up, man?
That kind of took me off guard, too, right there when you did that. But that happens to Zach all the time, right? No, I'm good now.
Yeah.
So,
you know, I mean, imagine walking down the street and every fucking 10 yards, someone's like, Rage Against the Machine!
Yeah. And that's happened numerous times. Like.
Yeah, and there's nothing wrong with that, except for at some point you just gotta be like, dude, it's like...
Like, he could be eating with his family or something.
I've seen that
a lot.
And
then someone walks to the table, bro! You know, and he's like, just wanted to eat his meal.
Some people just don't have the etiquette of where to communicate with people.
Yeah.
They just feel like, because you're a public person, that they have the right to...
To invade your space.
Yeah.
Because I mean, I've seen that with Bob and stuff.
Yeah. Because they think they know you. They think they
because they have heard your music or whatnot.
Whatever it is. You know, you've shared enough.
I don't know. I've never met him. I'd like to. Would you?
Yeah, one day.
Can I meet him one day?
Yeah.
I'll be really, like, polite. And I'll just you know, because, like, I do a thing where, like, you know, if I meet someone, it's, like, all respect. Like, I actually do a bowing thing where I go, you know, or I go, like, it's good meeting you. And then I just kind of, like, walk away. It's respectful, dude. Yeah. It's like meeting, like, if you were to meet a sensei or a master.
Well, that show, the one at the Globos, when Bill came and
oh, yeah. I mean, that freaked me out when Bill Burr was at our show. I'm like, what the? Because when he went in the green room, he, like, walked by, and in my mind was like, what is Bill Burr doing here? I don't know. Why is he here? And this just kept going around, you know what I mean? But you're the reason why he came.
Well, me and John, we brought him.
So tell the viewer, like, how did that happen? Because that made my night. No, you know, I got a good picture with him.
John was like, hey, Bill's he's a great drummer. He's starting to drum really.
You mentioned that.
Yeah.
He really paid attention to Dylan's drumming.
Yeah.
And so who's the other guy from Queens of the...
Queens of Stone Age, yeah, John Theodore.
John Theodore,
the drummer,
of Queens of the Stone.
He was a drummer in Mars Volta, and he's the drummer with Zach. But now he's
I was at Amoeba, and they did it in store. It was like, I remember the album cover was like kind of violet, right?
Yeah.
I think that was early 2000s. Yeah. But he worked on that.
Yeah.
It's a lot of sales.
Good.
A lot of record sales there. I remember ringing up a lot of those albums.
Yeah. But, you know, again, so it's like, that's what I'm talking about. Like, you know, people kind of think they know people, but they don't.
They don't.
You know, people have personal lives. Like, we're doing, you know, it's like everything. It's like, it's funny. It's like, I just met this kid the other day, and he was like, he wants to work with me and stuff. And he's from Phoenix.
Well, is he just a singer?
Yeah, a singer-songwriter guy.
And he sought you out.
Yeah.
He did his research.
His people did. Like, he's got some people who are behind
him. He's got a manager.
Yeah, it's Alice Cooper.
Alice Cooper?
Yeah. And he's kind of mentoring this kid. And
okay, because he was huge in the day.
And I know Alice, and Alice reached out, and, you know, so this kid came up, and it's just funny because he had that same thing. Like, he just thought, like, I drove around in a Mercedes-Benz, Rolls Royce. And
no, that's not you.
I lived in a, you know.
No, that's not
and
you,
it's like,
man.
And I'm like, no, man.
No, you're very grounded.
And but it's funny.
Very
it's,
grounded.
But it's funny to see people who have this perception of somebody.
Of because you're in music and you work with these artists.
Yeah,
and
you know, won a couple awards, whatever. But it's like,
wait. Let's tell you've won not just a couple, didn't you? You've won Grammys, haven't you?
Yeah, I've won a couple Grammys.
This guy's won Grammys. Those aren't just awards. That's like the elite of Grammys.
Yeah, my mother put it together one day because she came to the award show with me and she was like, that's like winning an Oscar.
Yeah, in the music world it is.
Yeah.
And you've won 4.
Yeah, and I kind of was like, I guess.
So you're like the Martin Scorsese
no,
music production.
They're little, they're tokens.
No, those aren't tokens, man. They're like full-on trophies.
No, I know.
They're
but
not a token. I've gotten tokens.
Look it.
there's a difference, a token and a Grammy.
It's nice to be recognized.
Or an Emmy, it's the same shit. It's Emmy, Grammy, Oscar, it's like the elite of that. Whatever, the arts.
Again,
or whatever.
It's nice to be recognized by your peers.
Yeah.
But I never, if you told me when I was 15
that you'd win 4 Grammys?
Yeah, I would be like, what are you smoking? You know?
But you have.
But if you,
that's crazy.
But if
dude.
You also told me that I was going to be a producer
of all of these artists?
Yeah, back then. And
you wouldn't believe it?
I wouldn't believe
it
because I was going to be, I'm going to be a musician forever, you know?
Now, how did you because you've been around for so long, like how, like, do you have any advice for people in your field? How do you sustain your career that long?
Luck.
It's just luck?
I think so, man. I mean, yes. Just, I mean, well, okay. I've done my Malcolm, you know, Gladwell's 10,000 hours, you know. I've done fucking 100.
Oh, that out of the book?
Yeah,
You work on your craft for a certain amount of hours every day.
I've got 100,000 hours, but.
Yeah.
You ultimately, it needs to be your life force. Like, making records for me became drinking water. I just needed to have it, or else I wasn't going to live.
Wow.
So, if you're that passionate about it, it'll find you. You know, I'm a big believer, if you hold your flag up long enough, they come. For anything.
So,
and if
you,
it's good,
yeah,
you know, has to be good, too.
I mean, how long did it take you to learn Pro Tools? I watch Eddie do it, and I still, he clicks on it so fast, and I'm like, what is it?
Yeah.
Is it like a video game? He looks at it like a video game.
Yeah, I mean, I Pro Tools, when it first came out, I had one of the first
versions
of it, yeah. And, you know, I looked at it, it was like, ah, fuck, this is going to go away, because I came from tape machines. Like, you know,
yeah, like the 4-8 tracks.
Well, yeah, I mean, 24-track
tape machines. Oh, 24-track boards.
Yeah.
Right.
That's where I grew up in,
yeah.
And it was like...
Analog shit.
Yeah.
And reel to reel?
reel to reel.
See, I like that sound though.
Yeah, but we've technology's taken the turn.
Where you can duplicate that sound?
Yes.
Because of plugins.
Well, a lot of things.
Oh.
I mean, you take like high definition television from, you know, the first version of like a box video,
yeah,
480p or whatever, to where we're at now, 4K, 8K.
Just different level
of and the
quality.
We've gone from here to there exponentially. Insane how fast it's grown.
Look at video games. Yeah. I mean,
same thing.
Worlds apart from Nintendo or whatever.
And again, it comes back to that thing where like it's reasonable technology at a reasonable price. Before, you couldn't buy a camera like that. It was thousands and thousands of dollars. My tape machine that I bought, Studer 827.
Cassette tape machine?
No, 24 track
machine. Oh, 24 track machine.
Brand new machine.
How much back in the day?
$80,000.
$80,000?
You can buy that machine now for $1,500, maybe even less.
Really?
Yeah.
Why is it so expensive?
Well, it was handcrafted made. It's like an expensive tape machine. I mean, video cameras, you know, from what they were, the first CCD cameras, you know, it's like, to now, it's like, it's incredible.
Yeah.
We take a giant leap. And that's what no one expected. And that's where the music business is now.
It's like just
we've taken a leap where
I mean, there's iPad things you could do, like GarageBand or on your phone. You could record a whole thing just on your iPhone. You know, it's crazy.
My best thing for people is you can make records anywhere on anything, but it has to be a good song. There has to be something about it that's good.
Yeah.
You know?
I like that. It doesn't really matter what you recorded on, as long as it's a good song.
The format is incidental to what the song is.
Now, what makes a song a good song? You've been around. You've heard a lot of music.
That's
like, let's let
question,
them know.
Man. A good song.
I'm trying to figure it out.
Yeah, I mean,
I don't know how to write. You know, I don't intend. Like, that's not my intention. Like, oh, this is, you know, because I rap about gnomes and, you know, weird stuff.
I think it's progressed to a lot of different things. And believe me, that we'll spend hours on that.
Yeah, okay.
But in
a
basic form, what it comes down to is something that a lot of people, it resonates with people. That's the easiest part. It resonates. Whatever it is. It can be a feeling. It could be a word. It could be a chant. I mean, you know.
Like an anthem.
An anthem.
Like, what's that? Eye of the Tiger.
Yeah. That was a lover, not a lover boy.
And
was,
you're going to hear me roar.
Yeah. La, da, da, yeah. Da, da, no, you're talking about Katy Perry.
Yeah.
I'm going back to the 80s.
Yeah, that was a damn good song. Yeah, I mean, the people, UFC fighters come out to that. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I mean, something gets you
that's
going.
That's a great song.
I'm going here.
It makes you like,
you know that Dre?
Oh, Dr. Dre.
I mean, that's so simple, but it's so powerful at the same time.
So it's not even about complexity. No. There's some kind of formula there, I think. I don't know what it's maybe more simple and more relatable is better.
I mean, you know, let's say Gook Boy.
Yeah, but that song's about, like, some nerdy Asian guy in his dorm room about, like...
I just see people going crazy about it, though, you know?
Oh, at the live show, yeah.
So that's part of it, you know? People
can relate to it. Just a little, since you brought that up, the reason why I wrote that song is because of people like Cho Sung Wee and Elliot Rogers, these Asian college kids that were, like, just snapping. But I knew the underlying reason why they were snapping. It's like, these motherfuckers aren't getting laid.
I mean, the best is
a
great
song. No girls are giving them no play. So, like, ladies out there, if you see a nerdy Asian guy at UCLA, you know, with glasses and he looks lonely, give him a chance.
Hook him up.
Right? Because this guy might come get you later, go to your sorority, fuck you! You know what I mean? I'm telling you, I'm being real. Like, that's why I wrote Goop Boy, man. It's like, for that guy, he's like, oh, no girl like me. I kill everybody. I kill them all. And then, like, that one motherfucker, the Virginia Tech motherfucker, he planned this shit out. He went to the gun range. He fucking got the right chains to lock the dorm room, the classroom door. I mean, he sent the tape to MSNBC. I mean, the guy planned it out. Ladies, give the weird, awkward, Asian, bowl cut student a chance. Go, at least go to Taco Bell with him or something. Or on campus, you know.
Hook a brother up.
Go get a burrito with them, or go to the student store, whatever, the on-campus store or something, or
but
get a smoothie or something.
Some of that awkwardness,
yeah?
Some of that awkwardness, you know, turns you into a brilliant person, too.
What are you talking about? Oh, you mean being that, like, neglected person?
Yeah, yeah.
You know what? I agree with you.
Yeah.
Because that could be a driving force of achievement and success.
Sure.
I will show them all. They will pay one day. Right?
Yeah.
I mean, dude, like my brother, he wasn't always like a cool, I mean, he's there, in San Diego, he worked at a restaurant, you know, he was chopping up, he was in the kitchen and he had something to prove.
Yeah.
And he realized it early on in San Diego, working at Disc Cafe. He's like, oh, if I get good at this, then I could get this, 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 and this. And it'll just, I could just create this whole different life.
Sure. I mean, right. I had something to prove, you know. It's this short Mexican kid from East LA, you know.
And now you've won Grammys. So that's great. All right, that's, man, that was a good segment, right? We did good there at the time.
Yeah.
I know that's more than half an hour.
45
minutes, dude? Can we get you back here?
Of course, anytime.
Will you ever come back?
No.
You will. You will. I got so much love for you, man. This guy,
come here,
he's a good dude.
I love you, man.
This guy's a good dude. He helped Monchi when he didn't, like, you just came out. You saved our record. He mixed and mastered it. Didn't ask for nothing. He just, out of his own love and desire to help people, he did, you know, and, oh, there's a sign at the warehouse. We all signed a poster for you.
Oh, good.
Like every member. And then we wrote a whole thing. So it's at the warehouse.
Hey, fucking Cho better not fuck it up.
No. Shout out to Cho. He's the reason why we're here doing this, because of me going on DVD ASA and everything. So I owe him a lot.
Yeah. Good guy.
Okay. And, you know, right about now, it seems like it's going to be I heard there's a cowboy around.
Really?
Named Ray. Raymond. But he goes by Little Ray.
Little Ray the Cowboy.
Yeah. He told me he's from Bryan, Texas.
I thought I saw him run by.
I think he's over there in an alternate reality right over there. Welcome to Little Ray's World Show. I gotta say is kids' minds must grow. I got abducted by some aliens and dropped in snow. Whoa. Stuck into a world that I do not know. So join me in adventures now. And I promise not to have a cow. My name is Little Ray. Hey, hey. My name is Little Ray. Hey, hey, hey. So welcome to my world. To all the boys and girls. Welcome to Little Ray's World. Well, well, well. What do we have here? You know what? Are you a Keebler elf there? No, I'm a gnome, and I want to take you home. Please go home with me. I'm not going home with anybody, man. You better keep your distance from me, man. You do smell like cookies, man. Are you one of Santa Claus's helpers, man? No, I am a gnome, and I want to take you home with me. I'm fed up with all this stuff, man. I've dealt with reptilians, alien greys, and a poo woman, man. Now I'm dealing with a gnome? Oh, yes, I am a gnome, and I want to take you home. I'm not going with anybody, man. In fact, I really don't like gnomes, Mr. Gnome. And you need to go back home. My home is Bryant, Texas, and I'm stuck in this alternate dimension, man.
Hey, Mr. Gnome. You better make your way home. This is Little Ray. I met a gnome, was all alone in a world of catacombs. Motivation wasn't known. I was born to throw a stone. Was he clone of Hobbit shown? Eyes were blown up in a zone. About to strike him like a drone. Head is shaped just like a cone. Wish I could just pick up the phone. Get rid of him like it was clones. When he speaks, it's like a moan. With the body like a kid that hasn't grown. Shall I dethrone? I don't know, throw him a bone. He might like it like honeycombs. I'm Indiana Jones with bones. Dress me up with cool cologne. Maybe make his nostrils foam. Send him back to his own home. I'm roaming after ozone tones. I am not his chaperone.
Next week for another episode of Little Ray's World. Let's get her done.